So the Hausdorff condition is the following, no? We have two different points. Any two different points have disjoint neighborhoods. That's Hausdorff. Or T2, okay? And T1 is any two different points have, each one has a neighborhood which doesn't contain the other one. That's T1. So these are two separation axioms, okay? There's also T0, and we will see T3, T4. They are not the same. So for example, if X is, X has a finite complement topology, a set with finite complement topology, is T1. This is T1. Why is it T1? Well, if you have any point here, okay, if you have any two points here, no, you want a neighborhood of this which does not contain this. And what is the neighborhood? That's the whole space minus the other point, okay? A neighbor in the finite complement topology, finite complement. You take the whole space minus this point. That's an open set, okay, which contains this point. Obviously, right? Finite complement topology. X minus one point is open. Okay? So X minus this point is open and contains this point. So this is T1. Each point has a neighborhood which does not contain the other point. Okay? So it's T1. If X is infinite, it's not T2. But not T2. If X is infinite, if X is finite and has a finite complement topology, what is the topology? Another name? We have a finite set and we have the finite complement topology. There's no condition, right?
Yeah. It's a
discrete topology, okay? This is Hausdorff. Obviously, no? The discrete topology is Hausdorff. Points are open, right? So, this is again, if you want, so this is an exercise, okay? So you have two points. Suppose two points, two distinct points have, I want to prove this, okay? Suppose two distinct points have disjoint neighborhoods, okay? Any two distinct points. Suppose. We have the finite complement topology, okay? Suppose X and Y have disjoint neighborhoods. So this is an exercise. U1, U2. So this would be X1, X2. No, X, well, X1, X2, okay? So it's, it doesn't matter, but let me call it x1, x2, u1, u2, okay? x1, x2, and this is u1, this is u2. Disjoint neighbors, so we are in this situation, right? This means u1 intersection u2 is empty, no? They are disjoint. That means x is equal to x minus u1 intersection u2. This is empty, no? And we have again De Morgan, always the same in set theory, almost. X minus U1, union now, okay? So it goes through the union. X minus U2, right? This is De Morgan again. But these two are finite, no? We have the finite complement topology. These are neighborhoods, U1 and U2, means that the complements are finite. So this means that X is finite. then we have the discrete topology and it's Hausdorff, of course, okay? So if x is infinite, it's not Hausdorff, right? Yesterday, he made a remark, somebody of you made a remark. So what is the definition? Let's give the definition of... we do have to give that anyway at a certain point, okay, and you know that, of convergence. So X is a topological space. And we have a sequence. A sequence, x1, x2, x3, in X converges to X in X to a point. X in X, no? So what is the definition? If for every neighborhood U of X, there exists capital N, a natural number, there exists capital N in N, so a natural number, such that such as what? Xn is in U for all large N. So Xn is in U for all N bigger equal to this fixed capital N. This is a notion of convergence, okay? That's the definition of convergence in general topological spaces. So we will write Xn converges to X, okay? If this is, that's a convenient way. Xn converges to X. And what you remarked, somebody of you remarked yesterday, so in a Hausdorff space, if a sequence converges, then the limit point is unique, okay? So observation. That's trivial, almost, no? If Xn converges, then the limit point, the limit x, is unique. Okay. So if you have this point x, this is a sequence xn, no? Then this is unique. It cannot converge because if you have any other point, y, okay, then we have disjoint neighborhoods. If it is Hausdorff, if x is, that's the most important, which I forgot. I'm talking about Hausdorff spaces, no? If x converges, then the limit point is unique if x is Hausdorff. Okay, that's the most important here. If it's not Hausdorff, one second. So if it's Hausdorff, then for any two points, we have disjoint neighborhoods, okay? And then for large n, this sequence is in the neighborhood u of x. This is small x, okay, in this neighborhood. So it's not in this neighborhood. All these points are not in this neighborhood, which I just showed, okay? So in a Hausdorff space, a convergent sequence converges against a unique point, to a unique point, okay? If it's not Hausdorff, it's not true. For example, the most stupid example is the indiscrete topology, no? In the indiscrete topology, every sequence converges to every point. There's only one neighborhood, which is the whole space, and the sequence is in the whole space, so that's a very stupid situation, no? In a discrete space, every sequence converges to every point. In a discrete space, what are the convergent sequences? Convergent sequences.
One point.
Not exactly. What did you say? The convergent sequences are constant, almost. Yeah. Not exactly. They are finally constant. So the first is not important. But up a certain point, they have to be constant. Not constant, but you say finally constant. At a certain point, they become constant. Before, it's not important, okay? The first terms are not important, right? So not constant, but finally constant, okay? Another stupid question, exercise. We have, let's say, the exercises are more pleasant than the theory sometimes. We have, let's say, N with a finite complement topology. The natural numbers with the finite complement, the natural topology with the natural numbers is a discrete topology, okay? The subspace of the reals, it's discrete, okay? The naturals. Now we take the finite complement topology, which is one of our examples, okay? The finite complement topology, this is T1, no? It's T1. Not T2, no? Not T2. T1, not T2. Not Hausdorff. That's what we just saw. So they take the sequence 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and so on, no? Does it converge? And if yes, what is the limit? Huh? It converges against 1. Is that true? Yes, it's true. It converges against 1. Any neighborhood of 1 has finite complement, so excluding finitely many, you have everything in this neighborhood. Right? Every neighborhood of 1 is open, has finite complement. So it contains all natural numbers except finitely many, which you can forget, okay? So up a certain point, everything is in this neighborhood, okay? All natural numbers are in this neighborhood, right? So it converges against 1. And what, and then, other points? It's not what? It converges against 1. Yeah. And there are other points? Everything. It converges against every point, right? Yes, right. 1, 2, 3. So each point, okay, it converges against any point, no? Because the complement is finite. So it contains. That's a stupid example, no? But that's the case. This is T1. So T, I said yesterday, in this course later, we always use T1 almost, okay? T1 is sufficient very often, no? But for convergence, it's not sufficient, no? So here it goes very wrong with T1, no? The unique limit, no? T2, it's unique, okay, the limit one. But in T1, we can have everything, okay? Well, maybe your question will talk later, okay? Because then otherwise, because I have to go on with this theory, I suppose. So why did we introduce this at this point? So there's a proposition, okay? Let me write this proposition. So proposition. So X the Hausdorff space. X the Hausdorff space. You never say T2, you say Hausdorff. That's okay. T2 is too technical. And then somebody forgets what is T1, what is T2? No. Hausdorff is clear. And A subset of X and x in x. So this is the situation. X is the limit point of x. So it's the same. X in x is the limit point of x, of a, sorry. It's the limit point of a if every neighborhood of x, if and only if every neighborhood of x intersects a in a point different from x. That's the definition, no? And now we have a Hausdorff space. We say it intersects every neighborhood. I abbreviate neighborhood of x intersects a in a point different from x is the definition of limit point, no? And now we saw in infinitely many points, okay? So it looks a little bit more like limit, but we still have no limit, okay? But in infinitely many points. Okay, so we come a little bit closer to limit now. At least we find infinitely many points. But limit means we have a limit, but that's still not true, okay? There we need another condition, a stronger condition, which we will see, okay? No limits, but infinitely many points. Well, okay, so sometimes I give no proofs. Now I will give two proofs because they are both easy and nice. So the first one, so here are two proofs. First proof is constructive, no? You make a picture. Well, let's make a picture. So we have x, we have a, and we have, this is A, this is X, and here we have our point X, okay? And now, well, one direction is trivial, no? Which one is trivial? If you have this, then X is the limit point, okay? So that you, I forgot to write, this is trivial, okay? So this direction, no, which one, the other one, no? Yes, this is trivial. So we prove the other direction, okay? So let u be a neighborhood of x. This follows immediately from the definition, okay? It's much stronger than the definition. So u a neighborhood of x, that's u1, neighborhood of x. Let u be a neighborhood of x. So here's u. So we're proving this direction, no? X is a limit point, no? So u intersects a, okay? U intersects A, this is not empty. So choose a point which call A1, U1. That's U1, the first one, if you want, U equal U1. So choose a point A1, okay? So A1 is here somewhere. To make my picture, you see immediately my picture, A1, here's A1, right? So X is T1, Hausdorff, but here T1 is sufficient. No, X is T1. What does it mean? X has a neighborhood which does not contain A1. Small x has a neighborhood U2, which does not contain such that, what is the first point? A1 is not an element of U2. Right? And we can assume U2 is in U1. We can assume I prefer to write in this. It seems that U2 is contained in U1. Why can we assume that U2 and U1? Well, if not, what, sorry? Yes, if not, you take the intersection, okay? The intersection of finitely many neighbors is always a neighborhood, so you make it smaller. You just make it smaller, okay? So can apply U2, okay? And now that's almost the proof, right? So we have here the smaller neighborhood, which is U2. So we make a picture, and now it's clear, no? So the proof is clear. So now U2 intersection A is not empty, no? Because it's a limit point. It's always a limit point, no? So let A2, okay? So we find, sorry? That's one, yes. So here's A2. Well, now I should make bigger this picture, but A2, okay? So recursively, we construct a sequence, okay? So recursively, define. So you go on with A3, no, A4, A5, define AN. Sequence. AN. All distinct, okay? Because we avoid everything what was before. All distinct. In where everything is in U intersection A, no? They're always smaller, 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 smaller. That's the proof, okay? That's a constructed proof. That's a nice proof, okay? You make a picture, big picture, no? And then you have your neighborhoods, you have the first point, you have a smaller neighborhood, you have the second point, you have the third neighborhood, you have the third point. And so you see the points, no? What we cannot say is that this converges to X, okay? That's not true in general. Then we need something much stronger, okay? Another condition. We don't talk about conversion. We have a sequence here, and there is here, but convergence is not clear. Why not? It's not clear because there may be too many neighborhoods of this point, okay? Which, there may be neighborhoods which have nothing to do with these neighborhoods which you choose, okay? Which are somewhere in some other, okay? Too many neighborhoods. This will be an important condition for a topological space, okay? When we want also convergence, okay? That we will see. But here we don't have. But still, we have infinitely many points, okay? So it's a little bit more limit. So there's a second proof. From the book. So I give two here now, because it's more interesting. So we still, 2i. So we still have this direction. Okay, we're still in this direction. So this is from the book. They're the same, equally easy, but. So let suppose, also here, x. So what is our situation? It's a limit point, no? We have a limit point of A. So we have a limit point, X, as before. And U is a neighborhood. And suppose U is a neighborhood. And U is a neighborhood of X such that the intersection is finite, okay? Such that U intersecting A is finite. But I don't know if X is an A, okay? I don't want X here, so I take A minus. Maybe X is not an A, okay? Then A minus X is A, okay? But this is finite, so I can, it's a finite set, x in A1, I don't know, how did you call that, x1, xm. Well, I prefer A, we are in A anyway, no, so A1, am. It's finite, okay? That's not what we want. However, this is a finite set, no? So this is open. We have T1, T2, Hausdorff, okay? Here we need T1, okay? So finite sets are open. Okay? Because it's T1 or T2, whatever you prefer, T2, Hausdorff. Finite sets are open. So this is a no, I don't. What do we want to prove? I avoided x, right? So this is not x. One of these points. So this is finite. Finite sets are open. So this implies that this is a neighborhood of x. So this is a neighborhood of x. Intersection a minus x. It's a neighborhood of x. It's open. It doesn't contain x. So it's a neighborhood of x, right? That's our definition of neighborhood. Which does not intersect A. It contains x. It's a neighborhood of x. It doesn't contain x. Yes, you're right. A intersection A minus x. So. So what I want, one second, yeah. I'm tired, then. Yes, I wrote something wrong. Let me, so. U intersection x minus. So this is A1AM. I'm sort of not in the best form, okay? Finite sets are what? In the Hausdorff space? Closed. Right? So the complement is open. Okay, so this is open. So this is a neighborhood of X. Which does not intersect A. The intersection which does not intersect A. Because we avoid these points, okay? The intersection of U with A, it might be X, we don't care about X, but the other points are these points, and these we don't have here, okay? We avoid these, okay? So this is the neighborhood of X which doesn't. So this means, this is also written in a stupid way. So this means X is not a limit point, right? So this implies X is not a limit point of what? Of A. Okay. So it's written in a stupid way also, okay? What?
I think we don't
Well, I prefer the first proof. It's constructive, okay? Yeah, I made a mistake. One has to concentrate a little bit, no? We need points are closed, but we have to give a proof, of course, okay? The first is constructive. This is sort of, well, you use something and you write something. One second. I don't like how it is written. This is stupid. A stupid way to write, okay? I don't know how it is written in the book. But we suppose x is a limit point, then we prove something, and then we write x is not a limit point, okay? This is a stupid contradiction, no? That's not... So, I correct this, okay? To write it in a... This is correct, okay? But it's not written in a nice way. So suppose u is the neighborhood of x, suppose... Suppose there is a neighborhood u of x, okay? There is a neighborhood u of x such that u intersects A only infinitely many points, okay? If there is such a neighborhood, then x is not a limit point. So if x is a limit point, then it intersects in infinitely many points. This is a better way to write, no? The other is this kind of stupid contradiction. You write something which you want to prove, then you, independently of this, you prove something, and at the end you write the contrary of that, what you wrote before, no? Then you can... So this is a good way to write, okay? It's clear, no? It's not a contradiction, no? We prove in some sense A implies B, not B is equivalent to not B, not A. So that's what we prove, okay? It's not really a contradiction. It's a... Okay, then what?
Okay, isn't the theorem, okay, if x is a half in space and A subset of xx is belonging to x, then x is a limit point of A, if and only if, I think, okay, every neighborhood of x contains infinitely many points
of A. That's exactly the...
Okay.
Yes.
So the other way is, okay, every neighborhood of x contains infinitely many points other than x. You can just execute x and get also infinitely many points. So every neighborhood of x, okay, intersects a in points other than x. So x is an point. And that's it. You can just easily execute...
No, one second. You have to prove that every neighborhood intersects in infinitely many points.
Infinitely
many
so
points.
If
yes. Now that you have to prove, that you still get infinitely many points. That you have to prove. You exclude x, okay? And then you still have to prove you have infinitely many points in the intersection. That's exactly this proof.
Okay.
It's not, I mean, it's easy, but it's you have to write something. It's exactly this proof, okay?
Okay?
You suppose you have only finitely many, okay? And then x is not the limit. Here you have to concentrate, okay? So I made some mistakes. The first one is sort of immediate, right? You see these infinitely many points, no? You see how they, you can construct them in some sense, okay? So that's why I give two proofs, okay? The first one is in some sense nicer. This one is more sophisticated, no? It's you use points are closed and okay, you have to write something, okay? Okay? Yes. But still, the interesting point is, we have a sequence now, infinitely many points now, but we don't have convergence in general, okay? We will see examples. And that's an interesting point. Still, we cannot suppose that we get a sequence in A, which converges to X, okay? That's what we want to have maybe, but that's not true. So we will see examples that this is not true. You don't get a sequence which converges in A, which converges to X. That, there you need some other condition, okay? Some stronger condition.
It's not an input, but
Sorry?
This point must be in that closure.
Yes. Yeah. In the closure, a limit point, let's say. Yes, in the closure, or a limit point. And if it's in A itself, you have a sequence now, a constant sequence. It's always the same point. So interesting point if it's a limit point, okay? And then you want a sequence in A which converges to this point, okay? Maybe you want, but you don't get that, okay? No, one second. If it's an isolated point, it's a limit point only if it's in A.
An isolated point is a point which is in A prime, but not in A.
No, no, it's not in A prime. If this is A, then this is not a limit point. It's not a limit point. So you have this, we are in R2 here, okay? Schematic picture. So you have here a neighborhood which intersects, so A is this and this point. Isolated points are not limit points. Yeah, if it's in A, it's in the closure, of course, but it's not a limit point. Isolated points are not limit points, okay? So it's not isolated. But still, you then we will see that you don't get the sequence. Okay, so now let me go on because. So this is an interesting condition, Hausdorff. Now continuous functions. We have to talk, of course, about continuous functions. Well, continuous functions, yeah, functions, maps, whatever. So let me give the definition. The definition is very easy. So, definition. X and Y are topological spaces. A function, a map, F from X to Y is continuous. That's the definition. If pre-images of open sets are open, pre-images. If pre-images of open sets are open. In other words, so this is a fast way to say that, okay? If V is open in Y, then what is a pre-image? F minus 1, no? Then F minus 1 of V. So F minus 1 of V, so this is a pre-image. That means all points, so the definition of Korff's F minus 1 has a double, no? It's not the inverse function. It might be also the inverse function if it's bijective, no? And then it's the same, okay? But in general, it's only the pre-image. It's not the inverse function. Pre-image, so these are all points x in x such that f of x is in V. That's a pre-image of V. No? That's a definition. If V is open, then F minus Y is open in X. For all. Pre-images of open sets are open. Well, we will say that anyway, but not now. This is the definition. The definition is also open sets, okay? No, for open for the moment. Yeah, closed. You suspect maybe it's closed. No, it's okay. You get to complements, no, and you look a little bit around, and then it's true for closed. You might close, but the definition is open. No, the proof that it's equivalent is easy. Okay, you go to complements. okay? Open and close are complements, and so the pre-images of complementary sets are complementary or something like that, no? And then it seems to be okay, yes. So what this I call I like to distinguish, call it the global definition of continuity, okay? Global. You have no point here. You have for each open set in Y, pre-image is open. So this is a global definition. Because then we have a local definition, no? This is a global definition. Okay. So let me call this I. Okay. And now I have a second, 2i. So local definition. Local means in a point. Okay. So f is continuous in a point. X in X, small x in capital X, fx continues in the point x in x. So this is epsilon delta, except we don't have metric spaces, no? So if for every neighborhood v of f of x, if for every neighborhood V of f of x, there exists a neighborhood u of x such that f of u is contained in V. So in analysis, in a real analysis, this is the given epsilon neighborhood, epsilon ball of f of x. You find a delta neighborhood, a delta ball in x such that this holds, OK? But we don't have epsilon delta here because we have general topological space. So this is the local definition of continuity, no? In x, local definition. So this is a local definition of continuity. So this is continuous in a point. And this is just continuous, no? This is very short, no? Pre-images of open sets are open. What is the relation between these two? Well, that's what you suspect, no? So, proposition. F is continuous. F from x to y is the same notation always. It's continuous. If and only if. F is continuous in every point x and x. This is a little bit more general, this local, no? You can say in some points it's continuous, in some points it's not continuous, so you have the points where it is continuous, no? So it's a little bit more general, no? So F is continuous in every point x and x. So that's the question. Proof? I don't know what is the, I mean, now what in general you take as a condition, as a definition in analysis, epsilon delta, no? But also this one, pre-images of open sets are open, I suppose, both. I'm not.
You work with metric spaces in analysis.
Epsilon delta.
Of course, you have
both. So we have two. We have two directions. This is f is continuous. So we have to prove this one, okay? This, we have to prove this. So v is neighborhood of f of x. So let x be an x. And v a neighborhood of f of x. Then what is u? What you take for u? This is trivial, this direction. What is u? So u, so this is a definition, no? You take the pre-image, f minus 1 of. So this implies f minus 1 of v. So this is open, no? A neighborhood is open for us. So the pre-image is open in x. You take the whole pre-image. And, of course, f of u is f minus 1 of v is contained in v, not equal to v, contained in v, no? It might not be surjective or something, okay? But it's contained in v. So this is trivial, this direction, okay? A little bit more interesting is the other direction. So which is this one, this one, this one. So now if f is continuous in every point, so f is continuous in every point, yes. So let v be open in, so I use almost this notation again, open in, but we have no point here. Let v be open in y. We have to prove that the pre-image is open, okay, in x. The pre-image is open in x. Now that's continuity. We have... to check a point x in f minus 1 of v. Okay. So let v be an open and take any point in the pre-image f minus 1 of v. This means, of course, f of x, then f of x is in v. No? So v is the neighborhood of x, f of x. No. So v is the neighborhood. It's an open set containing f of x. It's a neighborhood of f of x. But f is continuous in this point, okay? F is continuous in x, no? In each point. F continuous in x. In x, in this point, x in x. If you write, you see, this is small, this is capital, okay? Otherwise, sometimes, but it's clear from the f is continuous in x. So this means so there exists, there is a neighborhood u there's a neighborhood u of x, ux. It depends on x, no? For each x. So we call ux of x such that f of ux is contained in v. So what is then f minus 1 of v? Then the pre-image f minus 1 of v. This should be open, no? And what is it? Just write it this way. You take union over all these, no? Each of these, ux, f of ux is contained in v. So each of these is contained in, ux is contained in f minus 1 of v, no? Okay, applying f minus 1. Ux is contained in f minus 1 of v, no? Right? Because f of ux is in v. So you have this inclusion. And the other inclusion, because you have all x and x here, okay? If you have some x in f minus 1 of v, then you have an ux, okay, which contains is the neighborhood of x. So this is, by construction, trivial also, okay? Both are trivial. So this means this is a union of open sets. So open is open in x. And this is the end of this proof, okay? You just formally check both. Yes, thank you. What is u? F minus 1 of v. U. Not x. Yeah, right. Sorry, there's always some small, one has to concentrate on the notation. No, sorry. Get distracted. So x in u, okay? X in f minus, which is f minus 1 of v. No, it's this one. It is this one. Yes. Example? So in analysis, you have, in real analysis, you have continuous functions, differentiable functions, continuous, no? So you have the nice examples. Here you have the strange examples. So I take R. So this is the standard. And I take RL. This is the lower limit. Oh, is this continuous? Ah, identity. Sorry. Yeah, I wrote ID, identity. I abbreviate, I forgot to say that. So this is the ID is the identity, yes, sorry. Identity map. Yeah, right. That's, I always abbreviate identity. It's not continuous, no, not continuous. Yeah, right. I should have started with the other way, from RL to R is continuous, no? Right. So the general principle here, not principle, the general thing is that the identity map from X, T1, now I write the topologies. This is the identity, okay? Sorry. ID is the identity map. From X with one topology to X, the same X, because I have the identity map, no? I need the same X. T2 is continuous. If and only if. So a remark. So what should I write? T1 is finer than T2, yeah. No, and here you have that RL is strictly finer than R, okay? So it's not finer than R. It's strictly finer than R, and R is not finer than RL, okay? It's not finer. So definition, homeomorphism. Here we have one of the important problems of topology now, okay? So definition. F from X to Y. So these are topological spaces, okay? It's a homeomorphism. If f is continuous. In topology, we have continuous maps, okay, in general. Homeomorphism means isomorphism, okay? For groups, isomorphism, in topology, homeomorphism, okay? So bijective. Bijective. And that's not sufficient, okay? So what should I add? Yes, and the inverse map. So now it's the inverse map, no, not the pre-image. The inverse map. F minus 1, this is also F minus 1. From y to x is also continuous. And this is not automatic, okay? Why not automatic? Because we have an example before, no? The identity is from RL to R is continuous, bijective, but the inverse map, which is identity from RL to R, is not continuous, okay? So it's not automatic. We have to write it down here, okay? And for homeomorphism, we want that. And this is an interesting problem on topology. So this is a homeomorphism problem, no? That's in topology, homeomorphism problem. This, you can say, is one of the central problems in topology, in topology. The homeomorphism problem says that given two topological spaces, X and Y, decide if they are homeomorphic or not. Very natural, no? Given two topological spaces, X and Y, decide whether, if, whether X and Y, if there's a homeomorphism, then you say X and Y are homeomorphic, okay, of course. If there is a homeomorphism, then you say X and Y are homeomorphic, okay? I don't write, but it's clear, okay? Isomorphic groups, homeomorphic spaces, okay? So given two topological spaces, X, decide whether X and Y are homeomorphic. So I can write it here, are homeomorphic. Homeomorphic. That means there exists a homeomorphism, no? There exists. That's the central problem of topology. This one, okay? You can see. There exists a homeomorphism. F from X to Y. There are two aspects of this, okay? Two aspects. If you're given two, for example, examples. Well, I write minus 1, 1. X is minus 1, 1. The real interval, okay, in R. Right, this is a real interval, okay? Standard topology, no? Standard topology from analysis. And R, the reals itself. So these are two spaces, and you say, are they homeomorphic or not? What would you say?
Yes.
No?
No, they are the same because...
not the same, they are homeomorphic. Let's say, so... are homeomorphic. And how do you prove that? Construct the homeomorphism. That's analysis, okay? The what? Yes. Yes. It goes minus 1, minus pi over 2, or pi over 2. All intervals are homeomorphic, okay? Yeah, the tangent is okay. Yes. So, homeomorphic. Construct the homeomorphism. There are many ways to construct a homeomorphism, no? Construct a homeomorphism. That's the only way to prove that. The tangent is okay, no? But it's not minus 1, 1, it's minus pi over 2, pi over 2, okay? But any two intervals are homeomorphic, okay? Homeomorphism, by the way, is an equivalence relation, no? homeomorphisms or remark, maybe trivial, but homeomorphism is an equivalence relation and basta. It's an equivalence relation. On what? On topological spaces. On the on all. Okay, it's an equivalence relation. So intervals, all intervals. Okay, so and here, you can, as you say, I can take this interval now. They are homeomorphic. Okay, all intervals, all open intervals are homeomorphic. All open intervals in R are homeomorphic. You can get some linear homeomorphism. Okay. First, you can center around zero, and then you have a linear, okay, multiplication with some constant, no? Okay, if you have two intervals, first you translate to zero, right? You have an interval somewhere out in R, in the reals, no? Then you have the middle midpoint, okay? And then you get a translation, so the midpoint is zero, okay? That you do with both intervals. And then you have two intervals around zero. And then you just multiply with lambda, the smaller, where lambda is a ratio of, yeah, that's analysis. That's not so much our, OK? But the idea sort of is clear. So all intervals are homeomorphic. And now comes the intriguing question that I like. So problem, examples. Examples, that's the first example, okay. I. And now 2i. R, again, the standard. And now I write RL. Yeah. RL is a strange space, no? So you say R is a standard R. RL, that's some strange topology. So you say not homeomorphic. But then you have a problem, no? Now you have a problem, yeah. Here it's easy, no? Not easy, but you have two spaces. And if they're homeomorphic, you think, and then you see the homeomorphism. Here, you have to exclude the homeomorphism, okay? That's a different order of difficulty, no? You have to exclude. So in general, how do you exclude that? The only way, you need some property, some topological property, okay? Which one has and the other not, okay? So need some, one needs, that's the point, some topological property. So this I don't define, but we give examples, okay? Topological property, okay, which one has and the other not. A topological property is which one of these has and the other does not have, okay, and the other not. So we don't have many topological properties, okay? Sorry?
The pre-image of one point. One point in RL is open, but just one point.
One point in RL is not open. That's not true. It has not a discrete topology, RL. Be careful. Points are not open in RL. That would mean the discrete topology. Okay. Points are not open. RL is not the discrete topology. Okay. It's not. So you may say, I met at RD, the discrete one here. Okay. So let me write. Topological property. So, third example, Then you say R, and I take R D discrete, okay? And then you would say they are not homeomorphic, no, not homeomorphic. So how do you prove that? That this you say it's easier, this one, no? Why, how do you prove that R and R is not discrete, okay? It's not a discrete, R has not a discrete topology. No, that's the point. Huh? You say points are not open, okay, in R. So this is easy, no? Since, that's what you say, okay? Since points are not open in R, are not closed in R. Not open enough. Yeah, open. Since points, if there would be a homeomorphism, no, then points are open in R D discrete, and so the image of a point is a point, and the homeomorphism maps open sets to open sets. Okay, but this is what you say. Okay, since points are not open in R. R has not a discrete topology. Now that we know, okay? R has not a discrete. So that's a property, topological property. Points are open. That's a discrete topology. That characterizes a discrete topology, no? But that's a topological property. Since R has not the discrete topology. That's clear. Being a discrete space. Exactly, yes, right. That's a topological spectrum. Being discrete, okay? That's, yeah, this is different. Because we don't have many properties so far, no? And, yes? Yeah, that so in R, L, certainly we have open sets which have a minimum, okay? But this is a notion of order, this minimum, no? And now you say this open set has a minimum in RL, and now you apply F. And then you have an open set in R, the standard reals, eh? And then they say, this has not a minimum, okay? And, but why should a minimum be preserved by such a map? It's not order preserving or whatever, so I'm... all of these sets, 0, 1, they are open in RL, no? Of course, this is not open in R, that's clear. But the image in R, you don't know the homeomorphism, the map might be very complicated. It might not preserve the order. So then you have to prove that if this has a minimum, then the image should have also a minimum in R. Then I'm not convinced that you can, there's an easy proof to do that. Here, this zero.
One endpoint in R.
No. The map is very complicated, okay? The identity map is, of course, not. But this map is extremely complicated. It's on rational numbers, irrational. It's a big distortion map, okay? Which makes everything complicated, okay? But it's bijective. Well, you can try to that's an idea, of course, okay? You say this is a property, a property of... The point is that this notion of minimum, okay, and maximum, is not the it's not purely topological, no? It is order, okay? It's not purely topological. It has something to do with order, so we have more structure, okay? That's the problem, right? It's not purely topological. Okay, so this, there's a problem. So the topological property is Hausdorff, no? But R is Hausdorff, RL is Hausdorff. That's the only we know. And so now I give you the property, okay? Huh? It's a good point to introduce a property, okay? To prove that. Well, what short?
One?
You have to use some property.
Yeah.
Which one?
The open, being open set. Okay. In R, the only sets that are open and closed at the same time are R and phi, the empty
set. Ah, you are talking about, yeah, that's a good point probably. You will be talking about connectivity, okay?
What?
We will forget about connectivity at this point. Yeah, but that's, you are talking about, R is... that's true, but that you have to prove. I mean, this is connectivity. And this is, that we will do anyway, but that's true, you are right. Connectivity distinguishes, okay? Yes, yeah, connectivity. But then you have to prove that R is connected. Now that means R is, that's the definition of connectivity. The only open and closed sets are, that you have to prove. If you prove that, then you are done. But that you have to prove. That means connected. That's the definition of connected. And then you have to prove R is connected. That's true, of course, okay, in analysis. And we will do connectivity, of course. Now that's a topological property, connectivity with distinctions, okay? But then you have to prove a theorem first. R is connected, theorem, which is not completely trivial, okay? This is on the basis of everything in analysis, no? This is, of course, it's, yeah, that's a good point. The connectivity we will do later, okay? Not today, certainly. So we need something easier. We're talking, so it's a good point to do this because we're talking about bases, okay? So we have bases. We know what is the basis for a topology. And so the fact is, R so has a countable basis. So this is the definition of first countable. No, of second countable. So R has a countable basis. What is the countable basis of the reals? So what is the basis of the reals? The bases are all open intervals. And what is the countable basis? With rational points, yeah. So countable basis, all intervals, B.
Not all intervals.
No, all intervals with rational endpoints. Yes. B is equal to AB, a smaller b, AB in Q. This is countable. This is a countable basis. Why is it countable basis? Well, you make the usual picture, no? This is exercise. This is also one of the exercises in the book, by the way. So you have an, you have to prove this is a basis. How do you do this? You have the standard basis, no? All open intervals, and you have to compare. And then you apply the lemma, okay? So you take, this is an arbitrary open interval, okay? So what is it, CD? This is an arbitrary open interval. This is an exercise. And what, so we have, now we have this collection here, C, okay? The lemma says, this is a basis for our topology if, given any open set, basis element is sufficient, given any point here, we find some of this which contains the point and is contained here. Then this is the basis for our topology. That's the lemma, okay? And so how we do this? Yes, the density. So this interval contains
infinity
Any interval contains a point in Q. It's dense. Q is dense. So this contains. So we have this interval now. No, sorry, which one? This interval and this intervals, open intervals, no? And they contain rationals. Any interval contains rationals. And so we have AB, no? And rationals, and so we have X. So if you have to write this proof, then we have this, okay? And apply a lemma, okay? So the lemma says this is the basis. Okay? It's countable, it's clear, no? It's countable. Q is countable. So this is like a subset of Q times Q, which is countable, no? Q times Q is countable. Count, yeah. Countable set times countable set is countable, no? Well, that needs some proof also, but. RL does not have a countable basis. If this is the case, no, then we are done. Then they are different, okay? So this implies R is not homeomorphic. So this implies R. So homeomorphism you write like this, no? Homeomorphism. But it's not homeomorphic. Not homeomorphism is this, no? It's not homeomorphic to R. Because this has a countable basis. This does not have a countable basis. But if you have a homeomorphism, they are the same, no? Homeomorphism means we have the properties are exactly the same, no? This is a bijection, and it's just other names for the points, okay? But these are the same space with other names for points, okay? That's homeomorphism. So RL is not a countable basis, and that's a nice proof. So proof. That's in the later chapter of the book. But it has only to do with basis, so it's a good point here, okay? We define basis, so proof. It's in chapter, this we are doing chapter 2, okay? This is chapter 4, so I give the definition in a second of the property. So let B be any basis, we don't know anything, any basis for RL. So B is not this basis here, no? Any basis. And what we have to prove? That B is not countable. Okay? No countable basis. But we don't know what is this basis, no? Right? So the proof is easy, but nice. So we have x plus 1. This is open in RL, no? That's a standard basis, not our basis B here, no? By the way, the standard basis, this is a standard basis. This is not countable, no? Because we have too many points here, no? We have all reals here. We cannot, okay? So it's not so clear. You can try to do rationals here now, okay? But that is not the right topology, okay? You need all reals here. So this basis you cannot restrict to a countable, okay? That doesn't work. Well, anyway, this is open in RL. And X is here, of course, no? So we have a basis now, B. This we don't know, okay? Just some basis. So, but anyway, we have open set, we have a point. What means basis? We find the basis element, which contains the point, is contained in the open set, no? That's the usual stuff. So there exists Bx in B. So it depends on X. Such that X is in Bx, which we don't know, but it exists. And this is contained in x, x plus 1. This is an open set, no? Okay. So we get, and for each x, we can do this. We can find this, okay? So we have, for each x, choose bx for each x, okay? Choose some bx for each x. Choose an bx for each x and x. X in x is where? In R, in RL, no? R or RL. It's a set there. Choose such an bx for each x in RL, okay? So we have. And then we have a function from R to. To B. X, and for each you have such a BX, okay? For each X you choose this, because it exists. Right? And now, we want to prove that this function is injective, okay? That they are all different, the BX. If this is the case, then R is, so we have phi, function phi. This is not countable, no? If this is injective, then this is not countable. Right? So let's see. Suppose x and y are in R, and x is different from y. And then we can assume x is smaller than y. Doesn't matter, or y is smaller than x. X smaller than y. One is smaller. Okay, they're different anyway, okay? And then we want to compare bx and by. No? So bx and by, right? For each x, we have bx. For y, we have by, okay? So we compare bx and by. So bx and by. And we want to compare these. We want to prove they are not equal. No, that's injectivity, okay? That's injectivity. They are not, should not be equal. So bx is contained in x, x plus 1. By is contained in y, y plus 1. Right? Now x is smaller than y. X certainly is contained here. But x is smaller than y. X is smaller than y. So it's not here. So x is here, but not here. And so this implies bx is different from by. And this implies phi is injective. So then phi is injective right, and R is uncountable, no? And that means, so R is uncountable and this implies that B is uncountable, not countable. So this basis was not countable. So this implies there's no countable basis, okay? Because this is arbitrary basis, no? So RL has no countable basis. If you want to read this, this is chapter 4 of the book, okay? This proof. And the definition, so I give now the definition. So this is proof, okay? R, the standard, has a countable basis, rational intervals. RL, the strange topology, lower limit, has no countable basis, does not have a countable basis, okay? So they are different spaces. Maybe that's another proof is, of course, using connectivity, okay? That we will prove later. So there are various properties, no? But we have to find one. So definition. This is an interesting property, so there is a name for that. So definition. a topological space B AX is second countable. If X has a countable basis, it's a topology of X, of course. But if X has a countable basis, that's a definition. Well, this is a strange definition. I mean, we may just say countable basis, no? But we can say second countable. The interesting point is that second countable, you suspect that there's first countable. So you have another problem. So this, there will be another property, OK? That's why it's second countable, no? Otherwise, if there's no first countable, then you just say countable basis, and that's it, no? But you say sometimes second countable, because there's also first countable, which is another important condition for a topological space, first, that we will see much later, OK? So this is second countable, just a countable basis, OK? And this is a nice proof. RL is not so corollary. It's the same as before. Obviously, RL is not second countable. That's a way to say that RL is not second countable. The interesting point is that we talk is what is a topological property, no? What are nice topological properties, okay? This is the main point of general topology, the topological properties, okay? What are the important or interesting topological properties of topological spaces, okay? Whereas the main point of algebraic topology is not topological properties, but topological invariants, numbers, groups, vector spaces. For example, an algebraic invariant. Let's talk about 1 minute. It's finished now. About 1 minute about groups. Okay, there's a big difference here. If you have a homomorphism of groups, you will do algebra, but you know what a homomorphism of groups is. Okay, here for homomorphism of groups, this is bijective. Okay, then you have the inverse map, and this is a homomorphism. Okay, automatic. Okay, if you have a linear map between vector spaces, and this is bijective, then the inverse map is linear. It's automatic. You don't have to. You can easily prove that. Okay, in algebra, if you have bijective and preserves the product, then the inverse map is okay. It's the same. Okay. Isomorphism, it's called isomorphism. No. And if you want to distinguish two groups, that's here you have the homomorphism problem for topological spaces. Okay, decide if two topological spaces are homomorphic or not. Okay, if you want to prove that they are not homomorphic, you need something: a topological property or a topological invariant. If you want to prove that two groups are not isomorphic, you need something. You need, for groups, it's more algebra. So you need maybe a non-topological group invariant, OK? Invariant of groups. What is the easiest invariant of a group?
I'm just checking that the first group maybe is an element of order 2, and it's not element of order 2.
Yeah, for example. Yes, that's exactly. Invariant is the order. How many elements, OK? If you have a group with 10 elements and you have a group with 20 elements, they are not isomorphic, clearly, no? Because the order is an algebraic invariant, okay? The order of a group. This is more already a little bit more sophisticated, no? You have elements of order 2 in one, no elements of order 2 in the other. So they cannot be isomorphic, okay? Because isomorphism preserves order, no? Yeah. And so general topology is largely the study of topological properties, okay? Topological properties, Hausdorff, first countable, second countable, connected, compact. There are various notions always, okay? Not just one. And algebraic topology is studying topological invariants, okay? So this will be groups. We've studied in the second part fundamental group, okay? And then there are homology groups, cohomology groups, homotopy groups. Yeah, so there are many algebraic invariants, okay? So this is one difference between these two, general topology and algebraic. That's algebraic topology, algebraic invariants, okay? Dimension, maybe, but dimension is also a number, no? So dimension, as if a group is the order, no? It's a number, just a number. The dimension, but dimension is difficult to define. For vector spaces, the dimension is the first invariant, okay? For vector spaces, the first invariant is the dimension, no?
Every two vector spaces
have
the same dimension.
Yeah, here it goes in both directions, no? Yeah. First, it's only one direction. If they are isomorphic, they have the same dimension. And then it happens for vector space. If they have the same dimension, then they are also isomorphic. So this is a complete invariant.
Yeah.
But that's difficult to find. Vector spaces are easy in some sense, no? Groups are difficult, okay? There are many, you don't have anything equivalent for groups or for topological spaces, okay? So in this sense, vector spaces are easy, yes. I should give exercises, okay? And comment. So I made a small list. You have to write something, okay? You have to start writing, okay, in English. And next week I collect exercises. Because the final exam will be exercises like this, okay? And then you have to write in English, okay? You have to be careful and so I give a group of exercises. First group. These are, I comment on the exercise. What is easy, what is not easy, okay? So exercises. So page 83. And here's six. This I introduced because there is introduced, which we can do here, but you have to, there is a new topology on the reals, okay, which is also has some nice properties. So, and this is 7, but 7 is too long. So 7, only for T1 and T2. T1 is R, and T2 is, so this is the other topology, RK, it's called RK, K topology. You have to read what is the RK, this topology on R, okay? And then you have to compare these two. And this is also for RK. This is also an exercise for this topology, okay? So I give this exercise so you, and here you just give the answer, okay? Because you don't know how to write, maybe, okay? You have to compare topologies, no? And then we make my picture, okay? And you say what happens, okay? You just think, and if you understand, then it's okay, right?
So RK is introduced here.
Sorry?
RK is introduced.
Yes, yeah, in the book, of course. So just give the answer. Because you don't know how to write that in a good way, maybe, okay? You say, this topology is not comparable, or this is finer, or strictly finer, okay? What happens? You want to know what happens, and here's similar, okay? You compare RK with R, I think, okay? So you just think what happens, okay? Which is finer? Are they comparable, no? It's an exercise to think, not so much to write, okay? Then there are some formal exercises, and here you have to write. So just give the answer for this. Then page 92, exercise 4. Here you write. These are easy exercises that you should write, okay? In a good way. And also page 101, page 101. So these are very easy exercises, 10. Except you have to think how to write that in a good way. That's the main point. 10, 11, 12, 13. So this exercise, you write. Write the proofs, okay? Here you have to write the proofs. Write down the proofs. And they are easy. They are very easy. So it's not, it should be no problem. Except for the English, maybe, okay? And you have to formulate. And then there's the last one, which is like this one, where you have to think a little bit. But, and this is strange. Page 101. And this is exercise number 18. I hope I don't mix up. First of all, can you show me which one that I don't? Yeah, 18 is a long exercise. Determine the closure of the ordered square. No, this is an exercise for. This is an exercise for I square ordered, which is important. Okay, but it's give the answer, because it's too long to write this. Okay, you have to think what happens. Okay. And you just give the answer, like this one, OK? These are the formal exercises. Just give the answer. That means you have to understand what happens, OK? You think about this and just give the answer. Because otherwise, it's too long also, this one. There are 5 cases, no? It's interesting because you have to work with this space, OK? The ordered square, and here you have to work with this space, RK, okay? So these two exercises are because you have to know what this is and what this is, okay? So I give these two exercises. The other ones are easy, very easy. Okay, short. But you have to write in a nice way. That's the problem, no? Not so much for mathematics, but to concentrate on, okay? So these are the exercises for next week. And you write down. You have to write down because, sorry?
Any particular day
next week? Tuesday. Yeah. Yes, yes, exactly. 1 week. But you have to start writing. No, that's very important, okay? Because the final exam will be such kind of exercises, okay? 8, 9 exercises. If you never, if you don't do that regularly, you have a problem, no? There, in some sense, analysis and algebra are more computational, okay? Here it's not computation. Here you have to understand, okay, what happens. So this is. It's a little bit different, okay, the approach. Analysis, you have of proofs also in algebra, of course, but you have also computations, no? Here in topology, it's more logic or proofs, okay, mainly proofs and constructions, okay? And then you have to write it in a good way, okay? So you have to concentrate on the way how to present.